Eu sei, o jogo é duro, mas o futuro é no presente que começa. Se a gente jogar direito, haverá jeito de poder vencer a beça. Sua presença na hora da decisão. Pensa que um desatino não compensa. Sei que a vontade é imensa de achar uma rescisão. Eu sei.
Good afternoon to those who are watching from Brazil. Good evening for those who are watching us in the United Kingdom. Welcome to the Brazil-UK Forum 2021. I'm very happy to be here with you today and watching this event happening finally and bringing with the approaching topics that are so relevant to my country. To Brazil. It's a forum organized by Brazilian students in the United Kingdom that seeks to foster conversations about themes that are important for the context of Brazil. My name is Mayra Gramani. I'm a lawyer and I'm currently studying in a master's degree at the Blavatnik School of Government at the Oxford University. First of all, I would like to thank our sponsors that have made this event possible. Our special acknowledgments to the Haddad Foundation, IDEA Big Data, law firms Matos Filhos and TGMB Natura and Co. Thank you for your support and for trusting in our work. And actually, talking about work, I would also like to thank the volunteers who have been working in this event for over 8 months so that everything could go the best way possible. I would also like to thank our team for organizing such a beautiful event. And well, today we're here to talk about a very delicate and difficult theme, which is gender violence in Brazil. And exactly because it is such a complex theme, it has to be addressed here in an event that wants to think about a future, a better future for Brazil. It's not a coincidence that we have as a slogan, the future starts in the present. And if we want a future, a different future for our girls and women, we want to talk about gender violence now and how to combat it. I'm going to start our conversation before introducing our lecturers. I'm going to have some broad general questions about gender violence and how it's characterized. And then I'm going to explore more specifically the experience of each one of them with this theme. And finally, we are going to open up for questions from the public. It's for those of you then who are watching us and asking questions through this chat on YouTube, and we are going to then share these questions with the lecturers. And with no further delays, I'm going to introduce you to our three lecturers today. These are three women who are inspiring specialists in this subject matter and who deal with issues of gender violence. First, I would like to introduce Mafoane Odara, who is a psychologist, and she holds a master's degree from the University of São Paulo in psychology. She's a specialist in issues of human rights and reduction of gender inequalities, both in corporate and public sectors. She's the mother of Mudrick and McKinney, and she's an important voice in issues related to the challenges faced by women in confronting violence, maternity, and career. and institutional politics. She's a part of the Fund for Human Rights and the Institute DR and the network Lennon Foundation and the Movement Now. Thank you, Mafoane, for being here with us today. I'm also composing our table. We have Marina Ganzarola, Ganza, who is a lawyer, a specialist in cultural compliance, human rights, and diversity. She is an LGBTQIA plus victim of violence over 15 years, and she is an entrepreneur. And she has elaborated the Me Too Brazil. She is currently the co-founder of the Feminist Network of Jurists. She's currently on a doctoral degree in sociology and faculty in law school in São Paulo. She was the first lesbian to provide, to be the president of the Committee for Sexual Diversity and Gender at the São Paulo OAB. And finally, Marina Sperafico. She is an internationalist and she's curious about issues of gender and affection. She explores this universe through investigation, communication, and innovation. She's got a master's degree in gender development and globalization from the London School of Sciences. And she founds and represents an initiative in order to accelerate gender inclusion in universities abroad. And she manages ELA, a global community of LGBTQI+, and non-binary people. Marina was a part of the organization of the Brazil Forum UK in 2020 last year, and she has mediated a panel about gender in the last edition. Then, Marina, it's wonderful to be able to count on you. Then I would like to thank you for your presence here and to state that it's an honor for me to listen to you talking about this theme. I would like to start this panel with a reflection about what is gender violence. We are here. What do we want to mean by that? When we think about gender violence, the first thing that comes to mind, it's physical violence, it's the type of aggression that we are able to detect more easily, but the fact is that there's much more than that. Gender violence has psychological aspects such as harassment, moral harassment, and explaining what gender violence means, an iceberg, And we state that the part of the iceberg that goes beyond above water, it is the part of violence that we are able to see the physical violence and aggression. But we have several layers that are below the water, and they are part of this iceberg. So the layers that are more visible than are here, and that compose gender violence as well. Therefore, we have psychological violence, we have culpability, and we even have the objectification of women we may include. And hence, it is important to illustrate these many characteristics of gender violence. And I'm going to ask you, Mafoane, to start talking a bit about what are the faces of gender violence? How is this presented? What are the main characteristics of gender violence in Brazil? Thank you, Mayra. First of all, I would like to thank you tremendously for this gift, which is to be here with Ganza, who is a partner for many instances and struggles, and Marina, who is one of the people that I have been reading, and it's wonderful to be here with her. She's a very important researcher, and also to be a part of the Brazil Forum, as I've always followed it from the distance. So I know this program very well, and I'm very happy to see the work that you are developing. And I have I know students who are currently then following this path as well. And I'm so happy that you've been providing this debate to us. So first of all, I need to ask people to be quiet, it seems. I'm not sure. That's the way it is. Then I believe that we may start this debate about gender violence, bringing what are the main and what are the main barriers that prevent us to deal with this theme. First of all, we need to understand that gender violence is any violence, from a physical, psychological, moral, or property or sexual that is related to gender or sexual identity. So this is what we call this large, broad concept of gender violence. And then when we look at each one of these manifestations of violence, it's important to remember that three of these forms have started to be much more illuminated or made visible, which is psychological, moral, and property violence. This has been the many legacies of this legislation in Brazil, the legislation named Maria da Penha. This helps us understand that violence is not only physical violence. Psychological violence is the violence that humiliates it. It's in which we are threatened. Moral violence is the one in which you have defamation. This type of violence is the type of violence in which your dignity and your honor is offended. And the last one is the one in which you are not allowed to use your own money, destroying everything you own. But if he burns your books, if he cuts off your dresses, if he prevented me from working, though he has never hit you, so it's taking away your freedom. And sexual violence, we speak a bit some more, but it's not related only to the act per se, to sexual acts, but denying you the right to use the condoms and protection. So marital rape is something that we don't address very often. If you don't want it, it's rape. So this notion that you wake up and he wakes you up in the middle of the night, this is sexual violence. So it's necessary to provide this type of approach to sexual violence. And it's then the one in which people are hit by kicking and punching you. So it's really important to recognize the different forms of violence and understand why is it so difficult to talk about that. And the first point is we think we know what violence is. We don't. This is the notion. He has never hit me. It is a moment of anger and harassment. Oh, it's because he's a very nervous person. He's very nervous. And then harassment, moral harassment. Then we need to understand these different dimensions. And when I worked in the Institute Avon, we start to understand what did people know about gender violence, because there were some studies developed at USP in which we were studying these issues of violence. And the curious thing was to realize that when we asked people spontaneously if they had already endured violence at the university, only 10% of them said yes. And then we named the types of violence. It would go up to 77% more. And if when we asked this question to the boys, they said they had already been violent, and then it was an increase, 38%. The second thing that is very important is the mistrust of women in this services of support. And the third barrier is the lack of preparation to deal with different types of violence. And I think this is an important process in order to understand that it's important to talk about the best ways of dealing with it. Violence against women is not an issue of women. And finally, we have cultural barriers. Violence against women is not an issue about politics. It's an issue of all society. And the problem is that it's not among four walls that we should not get involved in this type of issues of violence, domestic violence. Wonderful way for us to start to reflect about this such complex theme. Ganza, before we throw the question out there, I just wanted to warn, to let people know that Marina Ganzaroli is Ganzaroli double L. Just this tiny correction. And going back, Ganza, Mafoane was dealing with several issues. We are going to go back to some of them. But I would like you to talk to us about how gender violence happens in Brazil. Good afternoon, good evening to those who are watching us in the United Kingdom. It's a pleasure to talk to you about this theme that is so important for me and that is the integral part of my trajectory and to be here together with Mafoane and Marina, who is a reference, Mayra, dear, mediating this conversation. Thank you for the team who has organized this, who has made this event possible. And with no further ado, I was listening to Mafoane, and she has brought some key issues. And one of the things that you have brought, Mayra, it has to do with the tip of the iceberg, gender violence. These statistics in Brazil, Brazil has this landmark in confronting violence, and the Maria Penha legislation is considered one of the best in the world, but we are still the fifth country in feminicide in the world, and in trans violence, it's the first. And since this is the month, the Pride month, LGBTQI plus Pride month in Brazil, so this legal framework that is quite advanced in terms of gender violence, we have responses that are totally inefficient, and statistics demonstrate that when we look at this tip of the iceberg, bringing this metaphor that you have offered to us, the statistics that go below the surface and trans feminicide and women's feminicide, if we have half a million rapes registered in Brazil committed against women who are 16, 13 years old, so this type of physical violence that we account in terms of in fact, it hides the structure of inequality of power between men and women that we call machismo, sexism, that is in the foundation and that we cannot easily account for. So it's impossible to talk about gender violence in Brazil without thinking about what it is to be a woman in Brazil. In 2021, within the context of the COVID-19 pandemic, we've seen an increase in violence, not because of this violence was already an issue in light of sexism and power inequalities, but now domestic violence obviously has increased within the pandemic and social isolation, but thinking about all the aspects of this iceberg and this problem that goes below the surface, we need to talk about the fact that we are 52% of the Brazilian population, and we're not even 15% of political representation in the National Congress, and that we have a large, we have 30 million female-headed households in Brazil. 4 million people don't even have their father's name in their birth certificate. So when we think about economic factors and social inclusion and economic inclusion, women have more academic training, and yet they are the majority in the informal job market and earning 30% less than men. And white women are earning 41% more than black women. We are talking about the experience of being a woman is not universal. And in a country that is intersessed by urgent markers that make a difference in terms of race, class, sexual orientation, gender identity, origin. So there's no way of talking about gender violence in Brazil without thinking about all these aspects, what it means to be a woman in Brazil. And unfortunately, so this legislation, we have an excellent legislation. We, the answers are very poor answers from the government in terms of our judicial system and our answers in terms of protection and ensuring these rights. And in particular, I would like to evince the serious issues regarding gender violence, because the executive branch that is responsible for this politics has been a budget cut, that dramatic budget cuts, and that has a direct impact in the lives of women and in the sad statistics that I have shared with you right now. Mafoane has spoken, and now, Marina, I would like to hear from you as well. What are the harsher faces of this gender violence today, currently in Brazil? Thank you, Mayra. I'd also like to thank for the opportunity of being here. It is really an honor, Marina Ganzaroli, and the invitation for being here, and is a new experience for me, and I have learned so much just by hearing this first comments, and it's actually a fact that has a great complexity, and we start this conversation in the expectation that we'll continue to have the conversation in the spaces where people are watching it. Gender violence, in fact, we think about the tip of the iceberg when we talk about it, and we talk about women's traffic and feminicide and extreme circumstances that emerge in the news. And it's something that's very interesting, which is why don't people know that that's violence when it goes beyond that? When we don't name it, why don't we know that that was violence? Gender violence nowadays comes down to these questions: how much there is intrinsic to our theme, which is patriarchy. Basically, it's our system in which we consider that men are inherently dominators, superior to everything and everybody, particularly women, and that they have the right to dominate everything through several times of psychological terrorism and violence. And how do we come to this violence, this path? is something that we need to reflect about ways of interpreting. So when we started to talk about this, sexist jokes in the workspace, little jokes in the street. So when we started to demand respect, people were complaining because the world had become this boring place. Jokes were no longer welcome. And we need to establish this clear connection in terms of what it, innocent term, which seems to be just an innocent joke, and connecting it to this strong notes regarding feminicide and the numbers, they are simply unacceptable. We are the second country in feminicide rate, just half our number, half our percentages. And when we talk about gender violence, it's important to define the gender itself. What is gender? And I always state that something I heard 2 years ago, which is a basic question for us to start thinking about this. The issue is not what gender is, but rather what gender does. What does it do? It creates and establishes this hierarchy, which starts when we have this baby shower in which we are there revealing the gender, baby genders. Why is it so important to know if it's a boy or a girl? I saw a video in which someone prepared the revelation instead of using pink, not yellow, of course, pink or blue, the person used several colors. The father and the mother were scandalized and they were outraged and they tried to find out if there was anything else. Who was that baby and what gender was the baby and why were they so very much bothered? This is the reflection we get from that, because the need to know the baby's gender has a role. The person who interviewed the father who had just had a son, he said, well, now you have someone to play soccer with you. And then if it were a girl, you wouldn't have that possibility. So boys have to play soccer. And then if we were to think about that, we need to think about gender identity, sexual orientation, and the violence starts there. Because if this child does not bring and fulfill all the expectations, it's going to endure violence. Violence starts in the home. Violence starts within the family. And that's why we naturalize this violence. Because that was taught to us as something. And for a child that looks at that expectation, he needs to survive and be welcomed. The father and the mother place these expectations. She or he is going to do whatever it is, whatever it takes to survive. But then it diminishes and it molds the team more and more. And eventually, nowadays, we break with those patterns. And that's what happens, is to have children who are going to start understanding that gender is not something to be taken that seriously. Yes, what we need to take seriously is the problems it causes. What kind of violence is it causing for peripheric lesbian black women? How these intersections are going to then render these experiences as unique for each person. So that we can work on that, we need to know about it and create more stable public policies. And we should then have solutions that are going to adequately address the problem. So, however, if we don't look back in terms of how we see the word gender and what it does, it is going to be very difficult for us to get to the point in which any legislation works at all, or actually work. This general overview in the beginning provided us with a good notion of what gender violence is and its characteristics. And I am going to comment now, Marina, that violence starts in our homes, and the violence against women starts in the household. According to the public ministry, 67% in the case of deaths of Black women happened in the victim's residence. Hence, I'm going to propose a reflection, because we may imagine that in this scenario that violence occurs in the households at home. In the beginning of the pandemic, things have been worsened dramatically in terms of gender violence. Aside from the load, the workloads that women have to face that have become more intense, many of these women saw themselves, caught themselves working at home, stuck with their harassers. And it's been observed in the study that there's been an increase in the number of women who were assassinated for being women, but there was a diminishing in the cases of domestic violence. And we may explain that because of subnotification and finding help during the pandemic. So, Ganza, you talked to us about podcast that was recorded for Oxford University, launched in March of this year. And in this podcast, you explained that it's not like the pandemic have increased this violence, but rather gender violence during the pandemic have increased the conditions for those issues to become worse. What are the challenges brought by the pandemic in confronting gender violence? And what are the measures and suggestions you're going to work and incorporate in your work as an interpreter? The pandemic is not the direct cause of the increase of violence, but rather it is what happens that enables this violence. Violence starts in the home. And it's very dangerous for women in Brazil from a statistic perspective. It's the household, it's the home. So when we think about access to rights and talking about violence, gender violence, we are already using numbers, working with numbers that are under notified. And this is going to happen at the peak of the cycle of violence. That moment of explosion in which there's physical violence, a more serious type of violence, even in psychological, it is a moment of explosion, like, for example, throwing something on the wall, and even if you are not touching her per se, you are sending her. So when we think about exes, they are not going to have as help for the first time to a neighbor, to a friend, or for people who are going to exchange words with you, and then this professor has observed something or another. Beyond the fact that the pandemic, COVID-19, has increased issues of pandemic violence, aside from the context of pandemic, how do you deal with that? At night, long series, we always have an increase in notifications because this violence happens. And besides, we have a different situation. The pandemic has made it difficult to have access, like for many women, we have had this indigenous woman, this Sperafico woman. Beyond that, we have to talk about access to rights, considering the under the sub-notification. And hence, it's already going against general statistics that the majority of women have to deal with. In order to break with this cycle, and thinking about this relationship, it starts way back then in relationships, in dating, in the jealousy, in this obsession, this control that is disguised, this care. I am concerned about you, and then from this care, this concern comes then, the control, who you talk to, what you do on social media, with whom are you speaking, where you're going, and this control then increases, and there are these then forms of demoralization and humiliation. And so that you can say that, sorry for my horrible internet signal, my apologies, as a privileged woman who is a doctoral degree at USP, at the expanded center, the neighborhood is in Neonopolis, that is a white neighborhood. I don't have access to the internet in Brazil. Just think about the realities of the population as a whole, 95% of this population, and the possibility of filling up a police report. It now, when during the pandemic, the social movements were already asking for that demand, and we state that for it took a long time for electronic files and it could be filled out, and only March of last year, as a response to this situation of the pandemic, hence data about sexual violence. Sexual violence has diminished. Has it diminished? I may not assert that, but probably it has increased as well, because it also happens within the household. Sexual violators are always related to the victim. It's a neighbor, a cousin, a father, but this bulletin, of complaint bulletins did not include violence against women. And it has to be then in person in order to file a complaint against the sexual violence. So, Boveitura de Souza Santos, what does it mean? What are the obstacles and barriers that need to be overcome in order to be able to access this system of protection that is already problematic, and there's a setback in the budget and funding? So as a professional and an activist, we sought to look for something that is well utilized in Brazil, which is an app, an instant messaging system in which you may exchange audio. Because for this woman, writing what's happening to them is an issue. So several initiatives in which I have founded in my group, it's also a response to these circumstances in the pandemic. How do you establish a bridge between this woman and the services provided by the state? Because this bridge is very hard to be established. The electronic filing, it is hard to be filled out. Of course, it's been an achievement to have this electronic bulletin, And it's not all over the state. So each state has its own bulletin and its own judicial system, and the one that is then able to investigate crimes. So we were able to have this electronic bulletin, but it's also very hard to fill it out. So resources such as projects that in which there is this establishing this bridge between the survivor and the victim, or a child or a teenager, and the system for institutional protection are essential in order to ensure some reporting. So these are initiatives like Angela from Avon Institution with Uber, or the project Justi Status. We are together projects, Estamos Juntas in Bahia. These are initiatives that try to fill out this gap and these obstacles, social and cultural economic aspects, so that this woman may have access to the judicial system in addressing issues that became worse during the pandemic. In fact, it is good news that you are able to file this electronic report. However, we see the barrier for access to the judicial system remain. Hence, I am happy to hear that there are organizations working so that this perspective changes indeed, because the pandemic go on, unfortunately. And we hope that the situation improves, and we are still dealing with the same context. Now, the next theme that we want to work on in this panel is an issue of intersectionality. When we talk about gender violence, we have sectors that overlap to the issues of violence that women need to endure. Then, oftentimes, we have the predisposition of dealing with violence against women without taking into consideration some particularities, particularly issues of gender and violence against women. And it doesn't depict the reality of gender violence in Brazil. And during the time period of 2006 and 2014, the lethal violence against white women diminished in 3%. In the same time period, in violence against women, 20% increase. It's an absolutely shocking data that evinces the need to consider the particularities of each woman when we talk about gender violence. Then, Mafoane, I would like you to talk to us about the importance of an intersectional approach when we are talking about gender violence. Yes, excellent question, excellent debate. Why is it so hard to talk about intersectionality? Because we don't understand what that means. Our way of thinking about complex issues, I'm going to go back to what Marina has stated when she says that gender violence is a complex issue. It needs to be addressed in its full dimension. And we have several social determinants. What are social determinants? Are aspects of our identity, issues of gender, sexual orientation, living conditions, place, race, and religion. These are social determinants that position us in certain spaces in society. And when we talk about intersectionality, talking about an adding up of identity issues that position us negatively or positively in society. And this positioning brings possibilities of protection or possibilities of vulnerability. Then when you talk about the three determinants that are structuring of Brazilian society, we are talking about issues of gender, race, and class. And it's not possible to provide a gender debate talking about issues of gender identity. It's not possible to bring this reflection without talking about issues of race. As much as it is not possible to promote gender debate without issues of class, these three components are structuring in society. So this whole debate needs to take into consideration, needs to be taken into consideration. Otherwise, if we deal everybody with everybody in the same way, we are going to have public policies that are universalist, only hitting or reaching people in different ways, because social status and your location in society affect their life condition. If a woman asks for help, unfortunately, she only asks for help when the situation is very dramatic. So something we've been stating when we talk about supporting women in circumstances of violence, if you endure violence, denounce it. But in order to do that, she needs to be strong. She needs to have emotional support in order to deal with this process. So when you talk to a woman and you tell her, you do not consider all the components of her circumstances. Denunciation is fundamental, but she will do it when she has the necessary resources to do that. So this is an important component. What is the best way then to support a woman who is a victim of violence? To ask her, how can I help you is to be next to her and not judge her? Because oftentimes we can't understand what happens to a woman who doesn't denunciate her partner. In this space, where is this woman? If you're talking about being a woman in Brazil, as Ganzaroli has stated, when you talk about being a black woman in Brazil, you're talking about the largest population of contingent. But on the other hand, it is the group that and it has the worst social index, issues of health, access to labor market, salaries, all the issues, housing. The majority of the women who are female household leaders are black women. The component, the identity component of race, along with gender, aggravates, worsens these processes of violence. So we cannot consider policies that do not take these determining factors into consideration. How do we do that? Because that's not true. Unfortunately, the theme of diversity is placed in Brazil in a way that is very superficial. And what do I mean by that? People understand diversity as the other. Well, let me just talk about diversity. It's not like everybody. We are talking about representativeness. And in order to understand that, we need to naturalize this issue, because diversity is a theme and it's not a way of looking at the world. So then when you start talking about inclusion, if you understand that a woman is asking for help, in order to support this woman, you should ask some questions. When a white woman vis-a-vis a black woman goes out for help, for a white woman, there is another issue that needs to be taken into consideration for black women or vis-a-vis black women. Same thing with gender identity. Why are we the country that kills trans people the most in the world? Because the issue is that if people want to say, oh, it's all women, no, it's not. The crimes committed against them, trans people, are more violent. There is a component of cruelty and anger that is particularly heavy towards this group. It's not better, it's not worse. So, and if we don't deal with these issues adequately, we are going to continue to endure inequalities. Thank you, Mafo. We're actually going to deal with this theme later, how to address these particularities in order to fulfill public or develop, implement public policies that actually help this and to provide support to this population. Thank you. At Marina, I would like to then address a theme with you that I think it's important to address here, which is affection, and considering that the behaviors, masculine in our society, they are actually social construction. I would like you then to explain what do you understand by social construction and gender violence. When we talk about affection, we imagine a relationship with somebody else, affection, the caring, and the aspect that I usually inspire myself when I did research about that. They are a little more different, right? It's like invisible threads that draws us like we are a ventriloque. Affections in that sense, then we have reaction. And it's something internal for all of us. It is something that has not reached our emotions and feelings. It's like an instinct. It is a quick reaction. And then when you put your finger in the fire, you pull it up immediately because the fire has affected you. And how then I have just come to, I think it's a bit of my trajectory. I come from a family that is very conservative in the interior of Paraná. And I was raised what it is to be a woman, what is my role as a woman, as a boy, for my brothers, of course. And what we are placing here in this particular way in the largest cities with the pandemic, we are changing this perspective. We are able to broaden access to some debates, but some conversations do not reach everybody everywhere in all the cities and communities. And it's very hard to create a new narrative in this space. And the narrative that we are placed at in some of these spaces is a narrative that roles are defined, religion as orientation that defines rules, that has its morals, the reference of right and wrong and hell and heaven, and all of that is added up in terms of the differences that we have along our lives, the movies that we have watched, the messages that they share with us about we are there in a castle waiting for a prince, and we are motionless about cleanness, and then these representations, who are the people placed there? So all of that creates an imaginary that, in fact, is not only an imaginary, it is our identity. It's our most profound relationships and who we are, trust, who is my group, what is my vision about everything that's around me. So when Mafoane says that we have, it's a way of looking at the world that is not diverse, our way of looking at it needs to be diverse, but it is not. It is extremely like a bubble. It reflects that bubble. And it's very difficult for us to move away from it because it generates fear, because we are not allowed to feel anger and aversion. So as a lesbian woman, and I'm engaging in this debate, and there's been another conversation that is also interspersed or informed by patriarchy and all these expectations that I have addressed here. But along my childhood, as a teenager, I started to realize, hold on, there's something wrong. Move away from the script. I'm feeling something that I should not be feeling. And I feel aversion to that. The world has taught me to have aversion to being a lesbian, though that was never something that was said clearly. But in some way, you understand, you know what is the reference. You know that heteronormativity is a given, and it is what is going to allow you to get compliments. You get compliments when you behave in a particular way, when you are submissive as a woman, when you accept things the way they are, when you don't react. And hence, what do I think that has something, why is this debate very important? Because if we want transformation, if we want to create a diverse environment, it has to start by deconstructing within what has not been deconstructed. And there's many things, but that generates great discomfort, gigantic discomfort, because you start to see that if you are dehumanizing someone, you are also inhumane. So how can you deal with that and understand that in fact it is a ship, a construction that was inserted in your mind and that you need to deconstruct and you need help. You need access to information and we need to advance to the next stage and not think that we are not talking about everybody. That's not what we are saying. But you also have your responsibilities. As a white woman, I have my responsibilities. All these places where we find ourselves in defining our identity, it comes with responsibilities and privileges. And it comes with this need to break with that. And hence, in this analysis, we see how much this reflects on the reasons why, for example, in relationships among LGBTQI people, violence is invisible and it's a taboo. Why? Because there are several barriers there. One of them is, if I am not able to have support in my family in order to be accepted the way I am, to be who I am, and if I know who I am, if who I am is in being interrogated, and if there's an expectation about me changing who I am, how am I going to denounce violence? And then if there's this violence amongst this homoaffective couples, this feeling of possession and control and use of force, it starts to then have a difficulty in asking for help, a difficulty in being able to open and being helped and asking for help, because there is a stage in which you are satisfied in deconstructing this within yourself. You are not going to be able to protect yourself. You ask for help and people are going to be like, look, women are hitting each other. This is friends hitting each other. So what is then the issue that doesn't allow someone to welcome this type of request? What is the first reaction that people will have when there's no perspective of a diverse world. So this is more or less what happened in these reactions that we have. They are so subtle that it has to do with defining who we are. And this is why it is so difficult to break with this, because we believe this is our identity. Thank you, Marina. It's very interesting, this definition of affection, because when we bring this world, this word, we actually have a different connotation. But it's good to have this perspective of affections. And I'm going to then link to what you've stated. But in terms of your comment regarding the need to build gender roles that were not imposed upon, that have been imposed upon us even before we were born. And Mafu, I would like you to comment a bit about that with us. How do you think, what are the steps that we should take in order to truly rebuild these roles and build a society that is more empathetic and open to other kinds of affection and to all of these deconstructions of gender roles? Well, I really enjoyed this debate in this last question that you asked Marina, because it is me at the core of this debate. I've been talking a lot about, as a psychologist, and psychology helps us understand that people are at the center of everything we do. And at such challenging times with the pandemic and a process of mental challenges in the debate that we have never looked at, debating affection has to do with debate and what we want to do in order to bring a revolution within relationships. Today is a very sad day in Brazil. We have lost one more Black woman to violence. Kathleen Romeo, 24 years old, so young. Once again, a Black family, and the stray bullets always find the same families. Until when are we going to think that these deaths that we endure are less last year, we were protesting George Floyd's death, which has had an impact in terms of looking at issues of racial inequality. But we need to look at the death that we have in Brazil, and we are talking about 120 deaths per day of Black young men and women who are being assassinated every day. And it seems to me like this transformation is related to three things. First, three aspects. If we don't see ourselves as part of the problem, we are not going to see ourselves as part of the solution. We all have a responsibility, and those who can do more should do more. So this space of empathy is not about walking on somebody else's shoes. It is about understanding your place. What kind of transformation can you have in the lives of somebody else? Men talking to men about violence, it means that people need to be able to understand their privileges, understand, and there's no merit or demerit. We are talking about a responsibility. I think that's the first factor that helps us take a quality step towards what we want to establish from now on. And if the pandemic has taught us anything positive, it has taught us that we are only going to walk away from this, because complex issues may not only be addressed by one particular group. And the third thing, when we look at the process of support, what does it mean to provide support? It has three important dimensions. First dimension is the individual dimension. How do I relate with violence? Because why are we in some way or another violent? How is this violence related to me? How do I reproduce that? The second is, how do I create an emotional safety for people who are close to me, my neighbors, my aunts, my cousins? How do we relate this network? How can I help you? How can we have this particular way of looking at these circumstances? And the third dimension has to do with institutional policies that may change these realities. If we don't have if we are not able to build significant concrete processes in the lives of people, we may no longer accept the deaths of people, and 70% of them are Black women, and we may not neglect psychological violence, but the violence that has really been killing in this pandemic, we've had that in national networks unexplained. So this is the dimension in terms of understanding the real broad scope of in having support in government, in organizations, in interinstitutionalized interventions, in which we have these isolated interventions. It's a problem of society. If we don't deal with it as such, we won't be able to address it adequately. And what has made it difficult for us to talk about violence? It is a taboo. Oh no, I don't want to talk about what's difficult. And why is it fundamental to bring this perspective? Because every time we talk about violence, it then becomes manageable. Every problem is addressed if you take the first step, but every day, creating new possibilities, new partnerships, new ways. Ganzaroli has brought us many of these solutions. So there are ways, and we need to be innovative in the way of addressing these issues. It is time, the time has already passed in terms of how we are going to deal with the issues we need to deal with, because when we deal with violence, we create futures. Violence prevents you from dreaming. So when we open the possibility of debating, we are creating a much better, sensible future, much more inclusive and much more harmonious. Everybody wins. Thank you. Thank you, Mafu. Wow. For this message, I think it's important to listen. Really, these are motivating, inspirational messages. And oftentimes we actually don't know, as you stated, where to start, but we need to take the first step indeed. Then I'm going to then move us towards our conclusion. And as I stated in the beginning, we received some questions from the public, and I'm going to provide you with a question. Ganza, I would like you to be the first one to comment on this. And the question is, how are we going to combat the resistance to combating issues of gender violence in spaces where this issue is not addressed? We have a situation of super polarization, and we have then this polarization that comes in terms of social networks and this culture of canceling. and more we have having great difficulties in breaking with these bubbles and talking to people who think differently from us. When we are talking about violence, particularly when we are talking about sexual violence, pedophilia, these are subject matters that cause people feel bothered and uncomfortable in talking about these issues because they generate a number of triggers. The amount of women and children who have undergone that. So oftentimes getting into the subject matter triggers past memories and emotions. So we don't know what the limits are and what are the dynamics and the realities of that person, their background, what they have endured. So it's very difficult considering how diverse we are. It is a challenge to talk to people who are different from you. How do you reach, and more than that, how do you engage with an agenda that is not a personal agenda of someone's agenda? It is not something that is part of their reality. This is a challenge, and it's something that for us activists, more and more, we need to talk about that. As we stated, it's something that is good and it's wonderful and we debate it, but we don't advance much. We need to talk to people who think differently from us. And in order to do that, we have to take a step back and be humble enough to understand that sometimes people are not going to agree with everything they want. We want them to agree, this search for consensus. People want to close the conversation in such a way that everybody enters into this big consensus. And this is bad because we are not going to be able to reach consensus in all points, in all instances. So if I can break this bubble and convince this person that has a more conservative understanding that it is important to establish a dialogue and ensure that we have this pride month and ensure the rights of people to get legally married, so then I may not be able to immediately convince this person of the need to debate abortion, even if this person does not agree with me in abortion, for example, because I may be able to convince this person of other issues, and then we advance. So a challenge in answering this question is starting with ourselves. There is an exercise that I enjoy very much, which is the circle of trust. Stop and think, who are the 6 people that you admire the most and who know you the better? 6 names that you admire and that know you very well. Looking at these names, 6 people. Or do they have the same socioeconomic origin? Or do they have the same race? Are all of them cisgender? How similar are they from you? So this is a question that we need to ask ourselves when we want to convince somebody else of something they don't believe that we want to reach, or their minds and hearts. We need to stop and think, how diverse are our circles? How many transvestites have you kissed in the cheek? We kiss everybody in the cheek anyway in Brazil. This is our cultural reference in Brazil, but a handshake. How many transvestite women have you shaken hands with? And if you're talking about Brazil, we have a historical and very serious problem with domestic labor. How many people have, as a white Brazilian person, have been in your household that you have invited to eat and drink something? Black people who are not a part of your social circle, who are not maids and doormen. These might sound like questions, but when we ask these questions, then I lecture oftentimes, and people wonder and they realize that they only coexist with people who are similar to them. And we need to stop and think about this. And since we are in this field pro-human rights, how much are we debating with the same people in Brazil, with all the progressive people, women, feminists who are inside these churches? How much can we differentiate evangelic religions in Brazil? So we need to learn to know what's different. And that's the only way we are going to be able to break these bubbles and spread these messages to other people, because this is an issue that is not limited to class, race, religion, political party. It has to do with all women. Thank you, Ganza. Thank you. Your perspective is really good, because when we are thinking here about the future of Brazil, if you would like to complement anything, Mafu, in this, about this last question, and how to take this theme and have people engage with this theme in places where this theme might not be addressed. I believe that Ganza has brought these issues for very well, the central issues. I only had a debate that once again, we are not only responsible for what we state, we are also responsible for what others hear. And if you have people or group that is very close to a particular theme, we need to find the best way to break with these barriers. And if we look at how are ways of speaking to people who think very differently from you. And in this research, we look specifically to issues of gender. And we understood that some words are triggers in terms of an impossibility of dialogue. If you're talking to people who are close to a theme, this means that you are just complaining too much. It's not like people are against the concept, but this word generates a negative trigger. So we need to, in fact, open this conversation. And the debate is that dialogue is much more a ceremony in which people are going to have reach a consensus rather than accusing one another of being right or being wrong. Another conversation is, how are we going to start a conversation without judgment? Accusing someone of being sexist doesn't help build the conversation. Well, if I'm a sexist, this is who I am, and this is who I am, and you are not able to understand me. So these conversations from man to man, they have great power in influencing the transformation of their behavior. So there's an issue in terms of communication that is fundamental to help us. And it's very important to then promote this debate for our personal growth, always. There is a conversation for those who work with non-violent communication. If you don't have, it's very easy to talk amongst your own people, your own kind. If you always live with your own equals, but if you live amongst differences, rather than your universes, the choices you need to make is, what kind of transformations are you trying to propose? So this is these are tools to help advance this debate and understand that people are at different spaces, because those who are ahead of us are the ones who lead the way, and it's necessary to talk to people who are in different spaces and recognize that growth is valid, because oftentimes people think, I'm not going to start this conversation because I know that people are going to question me. Creating a space in which people can talk about these issues help us demystify, and the taboo around violence needs to be removed so that we can talk about it, so that we can address it. Thank you so much for inviting us to think about ways of overcoming these barriers. And our last question, Marina, I would like you to address this question, and would you please be brief, because we are wrapping up this panel. And the question was, how can you demystify the notion of an abuser as the other, the monster, someone who's far away from our reality? Wow, this is an easy question. I think that we go back to the issue of, in terms of the way in which we want to create this other as an enemy. It's the same, the old and the bubbles and the right and the wrong that very much serve this system where we live, because we distance ourselves as though this abuser, this system did not exist within us. And if we depended on someone to save us, it creates this illusion that there is a good man and a bad man. So who is going to save us from the bad man? Is the good man. We continue to be dominated by the patriarchal system, in the same system that polarizes itself. I think that we start with this debate that everything is related to this notion of power, and the abuser, when he rapes and abuses, it is not a sexual act per se, it's not simply a violence that comes from interest. It's because he can, he may, someone who feels like he has the right to do it, it's because this person feels they have power over somebody else. And this may happen to us in our relationship that we have with people who we feel like have less power than we do. And these are people who are more vulnerable. What is our way of dealing with people who in our minds have less power, abusers, than perpetrate violence against those that they feel have more vulnerabilities? And in order to change this structure, we need to change completely the way we currently see the world. We see everything in very rational ways. We have this profound anatomy, emotional anatomy, and not only in terms of academia, but also in public policy. It goes through all of these spaces where we live. We currently, how many schools have psychologists and work with emotional support, mental health? How and then when we place this in our agenda so that we can deal with our own affections and fears and issues. And if I am in a relationship with someone and what happens, this violence, because someone has better income and this person remains there and she has to endure this violence. So how can we build healthier relationships amongst men and women who eliminating the need to put my power and show my power and enforce my power through violence? So all people may be potential abusers. And we, if we are thinking about affections that move us, obviously, it's not possible to work the structure in such a way that we address what's happening now. We need to work now in such a way that we are able to have abusers being punished. We need to diversify this communication, and we need to understand what's happening. The work needs to be parallel. We need to work on both sides, in legislation, and at the same time, in education and welcoming people so that we may understand what's behind it. I found that this was a wonderful way of concluding our panel. So then I would like to thank you very much, the three of you, for your support and for having established this dialogue with us and participating in this Brazil-UK forum, and for having presented so many important, or shared so many important reflections with us. I would like to repeat again today that it is because of women like you that I believe we may actually transform reality that is such sad in terms of gender violence in Brazil today. It is because of the work that you develop and what you represent for us as a whole. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Thank you. Well, our panel is coming to a close, but the Brazil-UK Forum continues. Today, we are going to have at 5 p.m. Brazilian time and 9 p.m. United Kingdom, we are going to have our next panel that is going to deal with an equally important issue, which is violence against the Black population in Brazil, which is going to count on the participation of Deborah Silva Maria, Silvio de Almeida, and Dianai Lopes. And the moderation of my colleague Claudia Alves and Natalia Ribeiro. We'll wait for you. Thank you so much.